is the importance of the new organizations to support professionals in their vulnerability. And this is a little bit the message we are trying to understand in which way the emergence of new players in the social dimension could help this scenario that we showed this morning and in the afternoon. So we would like to know if you agree with the important dimension of the new dynamics in terms of social dialogue and the emergence of new players in this field, and how you suggest to finalize better the next step in this field, in a sense.
So thanks very much. I hope you realize that you ask a person from an organization that is really representing social dialogue, because our members are workers, employers, and governments. So,
the problem of legitimacy that has been talked about before.
No, I mean, I think that the dialogue is a pretty legitimate organization. Next year we will turn 100 years old. And actually, but what you were saying, I mean, what I wanted to say anyway was that. The IO is very aware, and the IO Director General is very aware of the changes that are happening in the world of work. I mean, it's not just related to the organization of work and production or the governance of work, which is how I would understand these issues, but also it's about whether, you know, in the future we will be able to produce jobs for everyone. And then also the role of work in society and how that has changed. And in order to understand that better and also to better think about the ILO's role, the ILO Director General has launched the Future of Work Initiative in 2014. And it's supposed to be a selection process, and actually between 2016 and 2017 there were 114 consultations all over the world, at national or supranational level, that were supposed to, where stakeholders could express their views on how they, you know, what they think is important. And last summer, a global high-level commission has been launched. It's headed by the president of Mauritius and the prime minister of Sweden. It includes members from academia, NGOs, course employers, workers and governments, ADECO CEOs. They are supposed to process all the information that came out from this national consultation, these policy recommendations, and also guidance for the ILO. So from an IO point of view, I cannot now tell you, you know, what will be the answer, because actually that is the global reflection process that we're in.
What's your idea about it?
My personal idea about it.
On the role of new associationism, of new mutualism, of movements, of...
platform cooperative.
So, I mean, personally, I think that the work that, for instance, small PE does, or the kind of, I think it's important that self-employed organize, and there's a legislative framework for them to organize, whether that's in cooperatives or in trade unions. But I think for the ILO, so freedom of association, it's one of the, together with collective bargaining, are really two of the eight core conventions of international treaties that have been ratified by all the EU member states. So very important, right? And actually the Committee of Experts has said that self-employed are covered by both collective bargaining and freedom of association. So it's very important from an IO point of view, I can say that they have the right to organize and to associate. And that is interesting also, I mean, I don't know, maybe this point was mentioned this morning, but for instance, there were recent comments by the Committee of Experts, or the one that is looking at the application of the conventions, on the case of Ireland. I don't know if you know it. But in 2004, there was a collective agreement that covered the rates of pay and the working conditions of self-employed working in TV, radio, visual arts. And that was declared invalid under the competition law. Because in Ireland, the self-employed were seen as undertakings, and so of course if undertakings organized, it creates problems with antitrust. And so actually, from an Irish point of view, the Committee of Experts with Europe was very, you know, nuanced, welcomed that the law in Ireland was changed in 2004. and it promotes the right to self-employment, it isn't, of course, want to go against the European Court of Justice. But I think that in the future there will be a lot, many more of these kind of conflicts with competition law. From an ILO point of view, what I can say is that also in this report that I have, as part of the responses, they say that kind of coalition building, so trade unions cooperate with other associations, and this is an important way forward. That's what we see. You expect me now to say that social dialogue will be anymore? I don't think that. First of all, I don't think that's true. And as to the second thing that I want to say, that as to the specificities, and then I think I also look forward to 2019 when all these issues will be discussed by the International Labour Conference, to bring together all of our members and then have to see what kind of guidance they come up with. But in the synthesis report, so the synthesis report of the global consultations has been published, and what is interesting there is that you see also, like for instance, countries like Kenya and Panama also express the view that they see that more and more people want to work in flexible arrangements. But what I also thought was interesting is that from a European perspective, you see self-employment a little bit like a degeneration of the traditional model, right? Like the traditional employee
degeneration.
Feels like a little bit it's a step, it's the workers are less protected, it's a trend towards the individualization of the labor market. When you look at what countries have said in these global consultations for them, self-employment seems to be a way in. So a lot of the countries like Ghana, Rwanda, Seychelles, Sri Lanka, they see self-employment as a way for young people to get into the world of work somehow. So somehow it seems we have this kind of
traditional way for that.
Yeah, but they see
Latin America is very common to be self-employed.
Yes, but they promote self-employment as a way of entering in a kind of eventually getting to where I see a kind of the opposite. So it's kind of interesting just to see, I'm not saying either one is right, I'm just saying since it's report, it gives you a flavor of how countries outside of Europe see these kind of things. Leave it at
thank you very much. About organization, I will be a bit provocative. I'm a strong promoter of cooperativism, but about cooperatives themselves and social dialogue, I think it's mainly a debate on how the cooperative themselves should impose, employer kind of organization. Because a cooperative is an employer, whether you elect your employer or not, is the typical model of the cooperatives. But it doesn't mean necessarily that all the members of a cooperative become their own employers as soon as they are a member or working for a cooperative. So it's, I would say, a classical, I'm ready to discuss with your colleagues, in particular for Smart, but I would see it as a trade union, as a good old-fashioned trade unionist, as a challenge for the cooperative to impose themselves in the classical employers landscape. But that's for the organization. On the other side, if self-employed want to organize themselves for collective bargaining, for example, this will be a huge challenge for our economies, and not only for people, also for businesses. The Commission will soon launch not DigiEmployment but DigiConnect. Will soon launch an initiative that is quite interesting for SMEs in order to establish fairer relationship between SMEs and big platforms such as Amazon, Booking, marketplaces or market gateway, access to markets, those SMEs who are facing unfair practices from these platforms. And if you look at this, if you look at the details of the initiative, the reason why they have launched this initiative, you can find many reasons of unfair practices that also individual or self-employed are facing. And so at the end, maybe small businesses and self-employed will have also to discuss on how we should redefine or adapt our rule on competition law in order for small businesses to adapt, sometimes to organize or to mobilize each other, to mobilize together in order to negotiate some terms and conditions with the big players. And it's interesting to see that on the other side of the ocean, in the US, some big media enterprises, big newspapers, asked the Congress for derogation in antitrust law, which is important to the US. Oh, it depends how it is applied, but it's also important on their side. And they ask for a derogation just in order to negotiate with Facebook or Twitter or other platforms in the way they use the article they write. You know, so, I mean, it's self-employed is an entry point, maybe, to another broader issue on our economic model and the way
the
small are defended or can defend themselves against the big.
On that one, first I would challenge the fact that, you know, all self-employed are in a vulnerable situation. Again, we have to differentiate between different types of self-employed. Then you should look at what the self-employed is speaking from, as we say in French. Because you can be a self-employed. As soon as you have some employees, you are no longer considered as a worker, you are an employer. So again, you cannot apply the same, you know, principles and the same way of representation. It makes completely different. So that's also important, and that's why it makes also things complicated once again. But that's the reality. Yeah? Whether you are on account, you know, self-employed worker, then you can be a truly worker. If you have employees, you are no longer, you know, a worker. You are an employer. So that's the first thing to take into consideration. Then I think on that one, I would also invite you to go back to the past. And again, before the first industrial revolutions, we have this kind of hybrid animals, you know, beasts. They were called guilds, you know, in the Middle Ages and then in the next years. And the guilds were actually a mix of a trade union and an employer organization. Yeah. Because they were at the same time, you know, recruiting the workers, they were placing the workers, they were actually also speaking on behalf of the workers. They were also providing some safety nets, you know, for the workers, or in the case of an accident, for the widow and the orphans, you said. And you see, you know, new trends, new organizations that in a way are going into that direction. Of course, we all know the guilds were, you know, deleted or suppressed because they were actually against competition, because there was some abuses in the way that they practiced. But that's something interesting, because clearly what we see nowadays is new forms of organizations willing to represent either workers or the employers. So yeah, we have to take this into consideration. We have to look at the different types. For the cooperatives, yeah, it's an interesting one, but I agree with people. Yeah, again, you can be a worker within the cooperatives, but you can be also a shareholder of the cooperatives. So that means, yeah, you're still a worker or not, I don't know. But this is, you know, raising new questions there. But what I'm strongly believing is that more and more we need, quite like this coalition thing, we see that there is no one single organization or type of organization that would be able to provide the solutions to the new challenges we face in the market. Nor the trade unions, nor the employers' organization on their own. So then we have to start, you know, thinking all together, because we have to reinvent our social protection schemes. We might have to rethink about regulation. And then we need as many parties as possible. So I'm very much in favor of a multi-stakeholder approach, where we bring together different types of organizations, because I think there's very new innovative ways of developing social dialogue. But we have to take them in.
Thank you, Denis. So, how do you do it?
People have to leave, so I'll be very brief. But just to more or less we agree, I agree with what has been said by the others here. We are very interested. This is maybe the part of the report that I find the most interesting, because it really looks into the things that have not been covered that extensively, and really looks at concrete examples and what, and tries to put some sort of a sense in what is happening. One thing that I need, that I think that we should take into account when we're discussing this, is the will from the worker, whoever the worker is, to have their interest represented. And then in what kind of a way? Because we are talking about, if we are trying to look into the future, we're talking about people, young people today, who have been brought up in a world that is completely different to ours, who is possibly against traditional hierarchies.
future workers who, you know, spend their time on Instagram by Facebook, so probably some kind of adapted strategies will be necessary to be able to relate to that. Now, whether this is done in one way or the other, and how the traditional structures can adjust to that, is a different thing. So, yes.
Thank you.
And just to ensure the social protection initiative will be closely followed through your process.
Okay, so thank you. I think some key words in this part of the discussion were for the question of coalition, multilaterality, multi-stakeholders, I think it's very important. I was struck by the fact that each of the participants was using parallels or analogies with other situations, with developing countries, with SMEs, with the past. And it means that in a period of reinvention of the social dialogue, we have to take, you know, different backgrounds or different to think out of the box. It means that we have to think out of the box in order to reinvent the rules of the game. So thank you very much for your contribution to this roundtable, and I give the final word for Renata.
Yes. Words on what I think is missing in our project that are one actor has been missed, that is the employers and the employers' organization. So we would like to start a further research on this topic, because we have investigated the side of workers. But it would be, of course, interesting to deep also how companies can organize work, in particular platform capitalism, of course, and collaborative economies more in general, that exclusively use self-employed and not employees. So the future really is the proportion is now 60% in Europe, 60% of employees, all kind of employees, and quite 40% of self-employers.
50%.
No, it depends on how you count. But in any case.
For us, 60-40, but in the 40 we have the self-employed part and the
gold. It depends on.
But workers usually are employed.
Depends on how you discuss. This is how in our initiative we talk about the modifiers.
So yes, we will get close because we are tired, and I am very.
Don't open the box.
No, I'm very happy, and now it's up to us to work on the connection between the different parts of the research, and we will publish, I hope so, a book for Olga and for, and we have to decide the title that could be very
simplicity. But for the good cause, right? Give it for free.
So, thank you very much for your participation and for collaboration and cooperative support from all the partners and all the participants of this day. Thank you very much.
Maybe a very last word about the website. So could you remember the
it's www.iwire-wire.eu, and the documents are there. Most
and
of
all
the
documents will be available on this website. So thank you very much for your participation for this week.